And this is Ken Kraetzer for CBSI Services Talking Business, another episode of our series of discussions with leaders in the field of banking, insurance, customer service, digital marketing. And we are very pleased today to talk with Jeffrey Hayzlett, who's the CEO of the C-Suite Network, has a long career, including tenure at Eastman Kodak, chief marketing officer there. Jeffrey, good to see you. How are you doing today?
Good. I'm doing great. Good to be as expected, at least right now.
Absolutely. Well, we're all working to get through this COVID-19 period. Now, we had a chance to visit with you in person in December when you had a very successful event in Lower Manhattan, just off of Wall Street, about 250 or more CEOs and members of your network. That was really a great event. What do you remember from it?
Well, most of the people, actually, we ended up having about 850 over the 4 days that we were there. Every day, we kind of roll over a different audience depending on the C-suite and what we're doing. But always, and probably just good memories of that was the last good time that I had with a lot of different people, you know, face to face before we got into this mess.
Yeah, that's true. And I really enjoyed it. And tell us a little bit about the C-Suite Network. This is an organization, it's multifaceted, you're online, you're holding events, but you're bringing CEOs and leadership people of important organizations together. How'd you get it started and how is it going?
Well, it was an offshoot of something I was doing at Bloomberg. I had my own television show on Bloomberg for a while called The C-Suite, and it was so successful, I decided that, well, maybe we should take this digitally, and we should take it, you know, offline, off broadcast. And we created the C-Suite organization, C-Suite Network. So you want to think of it like a giant sequoia tree, and underneath this big canopy is this environment that exists with about 350,000 C-Suite executives that are part of it. We have different communities, different groups that you can join. We have the media, which is our C-Suite TV, our C-Suite podcast network, which is called C-Suite Radio, an academy, services, toolboxes, you know, all kinds of information that you can have. It's always about relevancy, reach, and reciprocity, and that's what we try to do with a trusted environment.
Well, you certainly have mastered being multimedia. You've got podcasts, audio only, and you've got a lot of video. What are some of the things that members and others who will go to your website, C-Suite Network, find? You really have a lot of material there.
Well, first of all, they'll find a trusted network, which is the most important, because everybody wants to know who they're doing business with these days, especially digitally. You know, because today we've been days have become weeks, weeks have become months, and months are now years. It's accelerated that much in this new accelerated model. You know, we talk about being digital, but more important is about acceleration right now. So they'll find great information, great insights. I think that's one of the things people are looking for. Second, they'll find a great trusted network. People are always looking to, you know, get with people like themselves or to punch above their weight, as we like to refer to it in the C-suite or in the ring, one or the other. And, you know, and then I think the other thing we're always looking for is ways to grow and what tools can we have and what, you know, networks can we tap? What people can we see? And so that's really it is, you know, our goal is to make you the most strategic person in the room.
Well, you know, one of the people we met at the gathering in New York was John Greco, who is an old friend, because I've been very involved with the Direct Marketing Association over here. Sadly, that it went out of business last year, bought by A&A. And he's very involved with a number of your organizations, the Marketing Impact Council and the Hero Club. Tell us a little bit about some of those projects.
Well, again, we have lots of different groups that are part of it, what we call councils or peer councils. One of those is the Marketing Impact Council, which is a leading group of marketers who get together and, you know, do a little brainstorming, do a little masterminding about, you know, what's coming, what they need to do to prepare for the next iteration of whatever marketing is going to be. And so that group gets together and then shares best practices, secrets, and insights. Again, it's all about sharing, learning, and maybe even a little cheering, and certainly right now a lot of caring. And that's really what the groups are about. Our Hero Club is a value-based organization that's that every single CEO signs a pledge, says that they're not going to be, you know, I don't want to use the word, but an asshat. Let's just say that they're going to, you know, put people above profit. They're going to do the right kinds of things to lead hero organizations, value-based organizations. And we find that when companies are value-based, We tend to see them gross more revenue. They make more money. They have happier employees, and they have customers who are more engaged. And of course, they're revered by their local communities for being great businesses. And that's, so what we try to do is pull people together in these peer councils and let them operate. We have a ton of them. It's our fastest growing area. And of course, we're seeing more and more of those grow now digitally or online, because it's not just about getting together physically, it's about connecting.
Well, absolutely. And we've all had to make the adjustment to working from home and working much more online than we did before. I mean, I used to enjoy going out to lots of the trade meetings and your events and meeting people firsthand, but that's going to be off in the future a little bit. So you've really been very good at making the transition to digital. What was the key for that on that for you?
Well, you know, it goes way back. I mean, certainly my days at Kodak on the marketing side, and of course, you know, Kodak was decimated by the digital world. You know, they saw it coming, but just didn't get behind it. They believed that they could live in, you know, what they used to be the past, and they were very entrenched in that. So they didn't really adapt to the digital side, which today it's about, you know, adapt, change, or die. I mean, that's clearly the models for business. But when I was at Bloomberg, and I one day, after I think it was my third episode, and of course I had the number one business show on the network, number one business show of any network, you know, in gross revenue, gross net, most watched, but yet more people were watching me digitally than were watching through broadcast. And I said, whoa, wait a second, what's going on with that? And they said, Jeff, you're doing a great job at this. And I said, well, this is interesting, but how are we monetizing it? We were giving away the revenue at the time. And I said, no, we're not doing that. We're going to go take this show online. We're going to do it this way. And that's how C-Suite TV was born. And with that, the C-Suite network.
Hey, you had a show in April on your network called the Battleship Forum. Now, today should have been the start of New York City Fleet Week with a parade of ships up the Hudson. I've participated in that for a bunch of years. Nothing like seeing the Navy and the Marines coming into New York City and the Coast Guard. But tell us a little bit about your Battleship Forum. I know you're talking with some military leaders in that event.
Yeah, we had the Battleship Forum, which we were actually going to do live for about 200 executives in Norfolk, Virginia, is where we were getting together. We were going to host it on the USS Wisconsin Battleship, one of the most decorated battleships of all time. First to use drones and video in warfare. So you talk about innovation. They were the very first of it in the military. And of course, that entire couple of days, we were going to be together. And we decided, well, we can't do that with COVID in the middle of it. The city was shut down. The USS Wisconsin was shut down. So we decided to do it digitally. And we did it all week long. And we had military leaders, you know, tested military battlefield kind of activity that was going on. And we used that to say, hey, how can we learn from that in business? So we had two rear admirals speaking. We had a commander who was in charge of the USS Benfold, the worst ship in the Navy at the time, and he turned it into the best ship in the Navy using the exact same crew. We had the very first female F-14 Tomcat fighter pilot to ever land on an aircraft carrier. You talk about, whoa, scary stuff. And of course, she was innovative in being the first female pilot, Lieutenant Carrie Lorenz. And then we had special ops, we had army captains, we had a host of others that joined with us as we had an entire week of battle-tested leadership techniques used that we could use in business. And so we had a great week. Coming up in June, we're actually gonna be doing one called High Stakes, where we'll be talking with some people from all over in high stakes businesses, primarily in the gambling industry, or the entertainment industry, where it's very high stakes. And we'll be talking about lessons they've learned and lessons they're deploying right now.
And one of the things I do, which ties into what you were just talking about, military leadership, is helping veterans transition from the military into civilian careers. Often you find, as you know, tremendous leadership skills in veterans at all levels. Well, what have you found to be the key for military people to make the transition into commercial business opportunities?
Usually it's always about connection, because each of us have our own kind of alumni group that we have. You know, certainly, you know, like when you're a chief marketing officer of a Fortune 100 company like I am, well, that's a small community. It's only 500 of us in the world. You know, if you expand that to 1,000 Fortune 1000 or 5,000, well, that's still a small group. Even Fortune 1000 officers, there's more people playing football professionally than there are Fortune 1000 officers. So each of us has our own kind of domain, and the military is the same way. The key is to be able to utilize your network to meet others in another network and being able to expand that so you have that opportunity. You know, there's some great companies that employ veterans and put them to work right away. And we have, like, even in our Hero Club, we have a lot of veterans who have gone on to be, you know, run very high valued base businesses that are very active in our community. I mentioned earlier at the Battlefield Forum, we had Bob Pizzini, Gary McGrath, both very active in our group. Bob was a former ordnance disposal officer in the U.S. Navy for 26 years. Gary McGrath was a captain in the Army, teaches I Got Your Back leadership. So there's some great military guys that have, and gals, military guys and gals, don't get me wrong here, that are doing a great job, and it's good to see them active in the business community.
Very good. Well, today, actually, Connecticut is starting to open up some restaurants and retail, and some other states are reopening around the country. But I think New York State is still taking a very cautious approach. What does it take now to start these industries that have really been shut down for 2 months, restaurants, retail, travel, and conventions? It's really unprecedented.
It is. And, you know, I think in some states, like I'm in South Dakota right now, we actually haven't been locked down. We had no stay at home, no lockdown rules whatsoever. Now, we still have like roughly about 5,000 people who have been infected up to this broadcast date, but still relatively low for our population. We've been practicing social distancing in South Dakota since 1889. So there's nothing new for us. But here's the key thing you want to think about as you get back open for business, and I'm talking about fully open, is that each of us as employers and as businesses have a duty of care. And we have a duty of care not just to our people, which are our best assets, but our other best assets are our customers. And so you need to have supplies, you need to have processes in place. And it's kind of interesting because even my own business, we're doing the same things others are about thinking, okay, what happens when an employee gets it, because someone's going to get it, right? And that's going to happen. So what do you have to do? What are the contingency plans? Then what are your continuity plans, you know, during all this change? Because you can't operate like you did pre-March. And then post-March right now in the middle of this. So even when you open back up and we think it's fairly safe, what do you got to do? And then third, what are your lessons learned through this? Because it's going to change your operations, or you might need to change your operations. So what are the things you want to put in place? And so there's, with crisis comes great opportunity. And we want to keep that in mind as we go back to work, to fully engage the way what we consider to be the new normal for the new world work order, as I like to refer to it as. So we have a duty of care, and then, you know, to take care of our best assets, but also then what things do we need to do? And, you know, and I outline those three particular areas I think are pretty important for you to be thinking of as you get back to work.
And Jeffrey Hayzlett is the CEO of the C-Suite Network. Jeffrey, maybe you could just, in finishing up, tell us about what's the eligibility, how someone can sign up, some of the different key activities of the C-Suite Network. We certainly have enjoyed some of the events and some of the online get-togethers that you've hosted.
Well, we'd love to have everybody that's eligible, and you have to just be a VP or higher of a company of a company of at least $1 million or greater. That's all we care about, is that you be a VP or higher, or tell us you're going to get to that million or $2 million in size, and we'll help you. We'll help you do that. So we have a lot of executives, VP or higher. We also have a lot of coaches, trainers, authors, speakers. You know, those people are trusted advisors to the trusted network. And so it's very simple to do, but we have all kinds of things you can get involved with inside or underneath that umbrella, that giant sequoia tree inside that environment of the C-Suite Network. All you got to do is come and check us out. But we have C-Suite TV, C-Suite Radio, C-Suite Book Club. We have C-Suite Loans if you need a loan. We have C-Suite Supplies if you need the PPE items for your employees and customers. We have so many other resources that we put together really truly to be a trusted source for you as an executive and help you grow and help you network and help you gain the insights, inspiration, and motivation you need every day for your business.
Well, Jeffrey Hayzlett, thank you so much for joining us. Again, appreciate the chances we've had. We hope to work with you closely going forward. And I just want to thank you for joining us on our CBSI Talking Business story today.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Our pleasure. This is Ken Kraetzer for CBSI Services from my home office in White Plains, New York, representing our team in based in Harrison, New York. Did a great job on customer service management for our 1,200 banks during the COVID crisis. So many customers of banking industry had difficulties and had to make changes due to the disruption in travel. And so great job. We always want to recognize our team at CBSI Services. So from my home office in White Plains, New York, this is Ken Kraetzer for CBSI Services.